Thank you, Mehdi. Thank you very much for a very, kind introduction and mentioning about the PhD. SDKs and code samples. Okay. So, hello and welcome, everyone. Anyone here recognize the place? Of course, Hobbiton, or land of hobbits. That's where I came from yesterday. And we have a company called API-Matic, based out of New Zealand. As Mehdi mentioned, it specializes in SDKs and code samples and developer experience components, and I'm here to share some of the learnings which we have, gathered over the year working with SDKs and code samples. Let's begin by asking a simple question. Can you guess how many developers are there in the world? Any wild guesses? Seven? Come on, it's just a guess. Okay, let me tell you. 20? 2 million. Let's see what Stack Overflow says. According to Stack Overflow, there are 50 million developers in the world, out of which 21 million are considered proficient developers, and rest are hobbyists or like me. So you can see the survey over there for the latest trends. So since developers are around for a very long time, I was interested to know how does developer experience look a few decades back, 50 years ago, what used to be called developer experience. And for that, I ran an experiment. Again, I am asking a question. So I'm not expecting anyone here to be expert in machine code, but any wild guesses, what function this machine code is depicting? Come on. Who said hello world? It's not hello world. It's a simple swap function, swapping of two numbers. And you can see the equivalent assembly code as well as high-level language code on top. While your system still understands machine code, but developers do not code anymore in machine code. Why? They can code still in machine code, but it is non-creative. It is redundant because developers' time is valuable. You need them to be focused on what is creative while abstracting out what is redundant. So at the back, you have a whole process that converts the high-level language code into machine code, but a lot of us even don't know what's going at the back. So the idea of developer experience is this, that let developers focus on what's creative while abstracting out whatever is redundant. And that's something not new. We have seen this over the past few decades, and now this is happening in the API world. So talk about developer experience in the API world. Let me present a small survey in front of you. You can see here some of the top APIs of the world. Twilio, Stripe, of course. Twitter, Dropbox, Slack, you can see over here. What this survey is depicting, basically, a synergy among the components of developer experience they provide. If you go to their developer portal, you will find HTTP reference docs with almost everyone, then code samples, tutorials, official SDKs. Just look at the number of languages all of these APIs are supporting officially. And then you have getting started guides, sample request response, and API console or interactive API explorer. So this is a list of features provided by the companies who claim to have a phenomenal developer experience. And if we know this list, then why not every second API provides all of these? The answer is bandwidth. Not every team has the facility of having a bunch of developers proficient in all the languages. And even if they have, for example, I can pay to a software house to get the first version of SDKs done. But maintaining it over time and keeping them up to date after every API update is something quite difficult, quite time consuming. And that's why we don't see all of these components in every other API. So if we look more closely, you can see two categories of developers working with APIs. On your left, you can see providers. Of course, API providers are there, who are responsible to design and develop APIs. And on the consumption side over here, you can see app developers who are consuming those APIs. And both of these tasks are creative. But what they end up doing? They end up doing, you know, on the provisioning side, creating, testing, updating docs and portals after every API update. And if they're providing SDKs and code samples, again, the burden of, you know, keeping them maintained and up to date. And on the consumption side, the problem is a little more severe because a developer has to deal with HTTP logic, or if you are working within banking API and you got a whole manual of protocols to be implemented before making your first API call, how difficult that sounds. And if I say, like, you know, work with OAuth 2.0 three-legged flow and obtain a token from server, keep it refreshed after every 30 minutes, it's something, you know, you can do as a developer, but why not just provide it, you know, automatically? This is something which is redundant, and that redundancy can be removed via automation for a premium developer experience for both categories, for API providers as well as API consumers. How? How this automation works? Let me take you a step back and let's see what's behind the scenes of an API call. At the very basic level, an API call is a set of input and output. Agree? With this input, you can see three components associated: configuration, arguments for the API call, and authentication credentials, which can be unique to any API call. What happens after that? There is a series of steps. You can see, like, you know, checks and validations, encoding input, serializing the body, and then building HTTP requests, sending the request, receiving the response back, deserialize it, decode the input, handle errors, and then we get the output. Among these series, you know, both of them, this part is creative, while these steps are redundant to every API call and can be encapsulated as software development kit or SDK. There is another name to this SDK called API wrapper, because this essentially is wrapping up an API call. But with SDKs, what you can do, SDK can be much more than what API wrapper provides. And you can have multiple, like, you know, features like caching, retrying, linking, validating. You can have analytics and everything with SDKs. So as we, APMatic, you know, specialize in SDKs, we can talk further about it if you want to know more. Our install is outside. The second component for a great developer experience are code samples. And I have heard that SDKs are, you know, somewhat argumentative topic, but code samples, everybody agrees, you know, that really help developers, and they should, everyone should provide them. Code samples are the quickest path to Hello World. And last night I was reading a very interesting stats from Twilio that whenever they provide code samples at top of a page, that page is more adopted by developers. And if they put a lot of text, like 10 lines of text, and then start code samples, then it's not adopted a lot by developers. Why? Because whenever a developer sees code, it seems native to him. Instead of reading a whole bunch of text, if he is able to read the code, he understands it better. He knows exactly what's happening over there. That's why code samples are quite powerful. Right now, the code samples are almost given by, you know, a lot of APIs, but I don't call them useless, but I will call them less useful because of two reasons. The first reason is those code samples are static, and the second reason, they are incomplete. For example, in this code sample, there is no way I can modify you know, the code sample before I copy and paste into my code. And incomplete in the sense, for example, OKHTTP client, I have this. And if I don't know what this client does and how, where to obtain it from, then it's like I have to, you know, spend time to get that. If I'm a proficient developer, that's fine. But what if I'm trying to consume the API for the first time? So if a code sample can contain all the information, complete code sample, then they become much more useful. So we can say, you know, for a better developer experience, the code samples should demonstrate actual and non-theoretical use cases. They should be runnable. Like developers should be able to prove that whatever he is seeing, it works actually before using it in the code. The third thing, they should come with code playground. That means setting up an environment for a developer so that, you know, he can quickly work with the API instead of, you know, just asking him to just set up everything. And for a better developer experience, the code samples at APMatic we call dynamic and interactive. And if I give you some example, is this. Over there, you can see a code snippet. And in the invite email, you can see my email address, which actually came there because I wrote it over here. And this, you know, code sample, this API actually offers one more item, which is an optional item. So by default, it's not on. But if I click, if I select this shared items, you can see a new object popped up. And when I fill that object, you can see over here on the right, the code is populated. And this is simple text field. What if my API offers multiple choice questions, multiple choices? For that, if your API has a multiple choice input, then even can that be converted into code sample. And if I select anyone from here, the code will be reflected right over there. So far, these are the snippets which require a developer to have set up an environment beforehand. What if a developer doesn't have an environment set up already or code playground? For that, a good code sample should be able to come with, you know, complete environment setup. For example, if any client, any dependency it requires, it should contain it. And of course, your input is coming here. And when you try it out, you should, you know, see the output and you can copy this code sample. So what essentially is doing? Recall the DX principle. The creative and redundant stuff. These code samples are basically blending both. You can see the redundant stuff, which is automatically generated on top and at the bottom, while in the middle, you can see the stuff which was added by a developer, which is creative, which is unique to the API call. So if you are able to provide, you know, such code samples, then believe me, the developer experience can really, you know, go to the next level. Now, coming to the second part, the second category, which is the provisioning bit. So if you are an API owner, if you provide an API, you definitely want to, you know, help your developers consume it so that the adoption rate of your API becomes good. But again, generating, building, testing, deploying is something quite, you know, time-taking. So continuous code generation, this is a technique which we use internally at APMatic. And this is, you can say, a DevOps extension or DevOps technique to generate, build, test, deploy SDKs and docs and other developer experience components. So the what's the problem with the API is this. For example, if you have an API which is connected to a portal, and imagine, like, consider you are a good company and take care of developer experience, you have all SDKs and code samples at your portal. Also, the API is connected to a front-end in Angular or React. And this API is also connected to back-end, or you can say a bunch of microservices. When the problem comes, you change one endpoint. What happens? You will have to update wherever this API is consumed. All the clients, all the references, and this could take days, even months, you know, if it's, you know, connected to a lot of places. So what solution we have found at APMatic for our internal use is this. This is a classic DevOps cycle. You can see, you know, something changes over there, you code for it, then build it, test it, deploy it, and for every change, the same cycle repeats. This is very typical, everyone knows it. What difference we brought as continuous code generation is this. For APIs, we say that this code can be automatically generated. Not every code, but for APIs, the client code can be automatically generated, while the rest of the DevOps cycle remain as is. You can build using Jenkins, test using Travis, and deploy it multiple places. And this is something really saves time and keeps things up to date. And essentially, how we are doing is this. We have an API description at the middle, and we are basically automating everything on the base, using that API description. You can see on the right the portal with SDKs and everything, on front end and the back end. So Mehdi, do we have 6 minutes? Ten, okay. So what I have done, I am almost on my second last slide. I thought if I got time, I wanted to show a demo, which I recorded this morning. So live demos, typically don't work. No, it's okay. I'm just showing the recording. So that demo will actually show the whole cycle. The change of API, automating the code generation, building it, testing it, deploying it on front end, back end, and the API portal. So this is the API description of a simple calculator API. And you can see the endpoint name as calculate, which takes in two parameters, X and Y, and try to calculate a simple mathematical operation. We have test cases because we're generating code, so that we want to ensure that test cases, unit test cases are there so that we know it works, code generation. So one variable X, second Y, 4 × 5, the expected body is 20. So importing that API into API-matic, you can see here. So the calculate endpoint is there. If I click test cases, you can see the same test cases. And again, 4 or 5 there, and the result is 20. So quickly going through it because it's out of the scope of the presentation, but just to tell you that this is a possibility. Here's an interesting bit, generate. So I am generating a portal out of this API description. This is a very basic portal. And before publishing, I want to see if it works or not. So selected .NET. Simple calculate, you can see the endpoint name, get calculate, and you can see the parameters over there, and the console. This console can help me testing it out. So the multiple options selected, let me select some. And if I go to configuration, I can select a complete file over there. You can see here. If I tried it out, it should add these two numbers. There you go. It's successfully added. Going back and copy the code, I got the first hello world covered. What else I can do? I can select some other option, and you can see the code changes right over there. I have tested, all is going good. What's next? The next is to publish it. And before publishing, what my goal is, not to just have zip files, but to add one repo at GitHub, Java GitHub, and one package at publish at npm. So for Java GitHub repo, I have to manually create one repo at GitHub. There you go. So creating a new repo with the name Java API Days _ Singapore. This is public initialize create repo. It's all created and it's all empty. You can see nothing inside. Now I'm going back and I want to link it with my Java in the portal. So go to languages, select GitHub links over there, and scroll down at Java. I am pasting this new repo. All done. So now it's being linked, and if I select Java, it should show me the link of GitHub view source instead of just downloading SDK. So time to publish the portal. So I am hosting it at a public URL, apidays_sg. Done. Oh, _ is not allowed. So from API description to a portal is done. And I can actually verify it that I have it linked with
correctly with my repo. So view source, if I click, I will find the same Java repo, which is vacant. And now I want to publish, I want to add some code to it. So I'm pasting it into my CI/CD pipeline and giving a package name that will be published at npm.js. So a package name could be API Days Singapore. Okay. So it's all saved. I am now going to commit. Oh, one more change. I want to change the name of endpoint as well so that you can see that portal has been updated. So changing the name to calculate for API days. Yeah. Now saving it, committing it, pushing the changes, and it should take 1 minute, which I have skipped actually. So yeah, one more thing. I am adding, since I have test cases, I am adding this repo to my Jenkins. It's synced up from GitHub. And if I write it again, Java API IDs underscore SG. So my repo from GitHub has been picked by Travis, and it's all good. So currently, it's being generated. Nothing so far. So I have linked it with my Slack as well so that I can exactly know if something is wrong or something is right. It's all good. So 1 minute, 28 seconds, the whole cycle took. Now coming back, going to the portal, I'm refreshing it to see what we got. It's refreshed. Let me see the endpoint name, if it changed or not. So that's calculate for API days. It's changed. And if I go view source, the same repo a minute ago updated, and you can go down and see all the code is there. You can see all the instructions, how to build, how to test. If you go in the source folder, you can see the test cases there, and the main class is over there. Second thing, I'm going back to the Node.js so that I can see if a package has been published. So view package, so API days SG version 1.0.0 published a minute ago. So it automatically published on NPM, and if you can do it at multiple repos. So the last thing is left, which is as soon as I deployed on GitHub, the Travis is running the test cases in the API. And once those test cases are run, you can see the result right over there. And it gives you the confidence that whatever you have generated automatically actually works. So 49 seconds, 50, 51, 52, see, there you go. In 53 seconds, I have now test cases verified as well. Phew. So, are you with me? Yeah, so last two slides. So this all I created this morning, just to save some time. So what you have seen, is this cycle. So something changed, automatically code generated, built it, tested, and deployed over here using a machine description in the middle. And what's happening at the behind, there are 6 APIs which actually made this happen internally. Important validating API, CodeGen API, DocsGen API, publishing Git deployment, and package publishing APIs. So we are using them internally, and if you are, if you really want to have a pipeline that works with your API description and want to provide phenomenal developer experience, keep everything up to date, you can think about a similar structure. To conclude, the gist of my presentation is this: know your audience, speak their language. It's very important because you cannot treat developers in a single color. They have associated, they are like associated with different communities. And if you're not supporting a particular language, you might be losing that community to your competitor. And how powerful is the concept of speaking the language? I want to finish by quoting Nelson Mandela, who says, if you talk to a man in the language he understands, that goes to his heart. But if you talk to a man in his native language, that goes to his heart, other one goes to his head. And developers are no different. Help them with a great developer experience. Thank you very much.
We have time for one question. One question, right? Who wanted to see more code, right? At the event, at least. And so he's happy with, I've seen some code here. Yeah, some people say yes, the others are shy, but I know you say yes. Just one question there. So it's kind of, do you consider it's even like a DevOps cycle, right? So you completely integrated the DevOps culture into that?
Yeah. Yes, internally, yes.
Yeah.
And our customers are using this again. Same.
Yeah, so do you even, when you talk to customers, like, are you talking just really about the DevOps cycles for API publishing or development?
Well, it depends on their structure. Yes, sometimes. And if someone is only, you know, they want to publish the portal and don't have, you know, a lot of connections with the APIs. For example, if you talk particularly about messaging APIs, they don't change very often. For those APIs, if you have published the portal once, so it's all there, so you don't need DevOps. But ideally, yeah, you ideally want to have this integrated into your DevOps.
Yep. Site. And the most used API description so far is?
That's not must, but if they use API description, that saves a lot of time. Yeah. Okay. Internally, we use API description, and that's how we are able to offer apitransformer.com. And you might have used it. There's like, you know, that you can be used to transform among different API formats. So yeah, we are in API first and API description, very proto API descriptions.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you, Adil.
Thank you very much for having me.